So passwords are hashed. Are you completely safe? No. Sorry to lead you down this path. We have more to do. The problem is there are, you know, a handful of good hashing algorithms that people would use for this sort of thing. You know, let's pretend we're using SHA-256 because that's a pretty decent hash algorithm. If someone were to go through and create a mapping of every word to the hash of that word, that would be a problem. Because remember, the whole strength of this hashing problem is that it's really hard to get from the hash to the plain text that led to that hash. You know, to if you have H of A, you know, the hash of A, it's really hard to figure out A. But if you've already computed it for every word, and all you have to do is compute it once and create the inverse table, once somebody has this table of all of these words computed once, they're done. You know, if you created a mapping of, you know, the SHA-256 of every word to the original word, all of a sudden you get a database of a bunch of SHA-256 passwords, you can look up what the password is instantly. And this table has a name. It's called a rainbow table. There are these things, these mappings, these databases of a hashed version of a password to the clear text password. They exist. You can Google for a rainbow table for a hash algorithm of your choice, you know, download that hash table. Or, you know, download that mapping, turn it into a hash table, and you're good to go. There's a very simple way to get around this. You may remember from our cookie approach that all we have to do is add in some secrets. But we don't want to add in the same secret over and over again. Otherwise, you're basically vulnerable to the same, very similar technique. So what we do instead is we use something called a salt. So in our user table, we're storing our name, and we're storing a hash of the password. Instead of storing just a hash of the password, we're going to add a secret to it. Similar to how we did with the cookies, except this is not really a secret. We're just going to say this hash is going to equal our hashing function of the password plus salt. And this salt, instead of, so this looks very similar to what we did with the cookies, right? We were using HMAC and we had a password and a secret. Instead, the salt is just, it's just some random characters we make up. You can make them up and you store them in the hash field. In the clear. So in this field, we'll actually have the hash, and we'll just abbreviate that as H, and right along with it, we'll have the salt. And what this does is this prevents this quick lookup from working, because all of a sudden we've added this these random strings. So instead of saying hash of A equals A, we have to figure out what's hash of A, you know, plus the salt. And all of a sudden that table is completely invalid. So when you store a user, you know, this is the type of algorithm you can do. Now, outside of this class, I want you to think very hard about doing this yourself. You know, as with all crypto, you should probably not be implementing it yourself because people have thought this through, they've done it securely, and you are not yet qualified to do so. I want you to think very hard about using third-party libraries, because a lot of third-party libraries also get this wrong. So basically, think very hard. You want to get this right. There's a couple more things I'll tell you to look for when you're evaluating a third-party library, but a lot of them really screw this up, and you don't want to just trust them blindly. So, you know, I'd rather you do it yourself knowing how to do it than you trust a third-party library blindly. But the best knowledge you can have is what to look for in a third-party authentication library. Let's go ahead and implement some naive functions for, you know, hashing and salting a password so you can see how the flow works. And then we'll talk about some of the things you should look for when you're evaluating, you know, somebody's approach.